101. And today we're going to talk about mental health. And with me, we have
Will D.
And then we have Wilson. Well, you.
Oh, Wilson. My bad. I was turning on the thing. Wait.
You always want to go last.
There we go.
My bad. That's on me. So we have
D-Train.
Take the ride.
D-Train.
Take a ride on me. Okay, what? Now you're coming back on me?
Yeah.
Naughty.
My bad, y'all. I'm sorry. So what's your name?
My name is Wilson.
DJ Horns Wilson.
There we go.
Something like that.
Charles, right, in the house.
Wilson
Pickett. No, but today we're going to talk about mental health.
That's a funny way to start.
No.
We're talking about mental health.
Yeah. Because I listened to the episode about 2 years ago about mental health, and I noticed like it's a big fucking change.
Oh yeah.
So the biggest change I noticed is we were talking about minorities then, and how they were like when it came to mental health, we were like ashamed of it. Now, it's like all over the fucking place. Like we're like really, really, really extra supportive over mental health. Why?
Because now they know they can get a free check.
Nah, those are the ones that have been doing it at the system. No, I'm serious. But, I mean, you have a lot that's changed in the last 2 years in general, right? And a lot of the youth speaking up in the last 2 years, in the last 5 years, really. So when you have a younger, generation becoming a louder voice, I think it skews the perception. I don't think there's anything that's actually changed in the overall community. It's just that now there's more of the community that's accepting of this thought process, voicing their opinion. You still talk to the same black people over a certain age, and they're going to tell you the same shit.
Yep.
But everybody under, let's say, 25, lower generation millennials and, Gen Zers, now they have a different opinion, and they were raised with a different opinion. In general, they're more just liberal and open and woke, in a sense.
That makes me wonder if that's why the music is the way it is with this generation, now that you say that.
Well, I mean, look at, what was that, XXXTentacion
and
all that other stuff, and it's a whole bunch of, these depressed ghetto rappers. But then you see a lot of these other people in an age group where, being a millennial, you're in the crossing of the guard, in a sense, right? So, there's some of us who have older opinions, some of us who have younger, some of us who are just, regardless of what we think, we're open or we don't judge people of their perspective, right? Because everybody in our age group is on some end of the spectrum. And I know a lot of guys who are younger than me normally are like, yeah, these guys are the greatest. They're making our kind of rap music now, da-da-da-da. And you're like, I heard what they're making. I'm like, nah, bro, this ain't rap. This is its own genre.
The
other ones were just like, this ain't music. But, music itself is constantly changing. So to say something isn't, art is kind of bullcrap. But, it may not be conventional. And I think that's where a lot of people are drawing the line, even with the mumble rap nonsense and stuff like that. So this, because you now have a louder voice, they're saying how, the idea of all these conservatives and whatever is eventually going to age out. If stuff can age out, stuff can age in, and essentially that's what's happening with this stuff in our community now, where people are aware of and talking about and feel like it's valid to associate these mental health issues. I think the other thing is that as we're fighting for equality, right, in all aspects of life for all social groups, there's this standard or what the goal is to be treated as, white people in a sense. And essentially, when white people take and address mental health as an actual illness and ailment, right, and we as a people get to see that it excuses them out of certain things or that they get extra resources because of the X, Y, and Z, why wouldn't we want those same privileges, in a sense? So whether or not we're actually taking it seriously and valid or just looking for a way to get resources would change the perception of why some people are like, well, maybe we should acknowledge this. The Naomi Osaka situation that's, happening in tennis. At first they're trying to ban the girl, and then they had to think about it and said, wait, there's a whole generation of people who follow this girl that are following our sports because of this girl and that feel the same way about mental illness, that instead of talking about that ban initially, now they're trying to figure out how do we address this with the responsibilities of our major athletes. it's just a part of how everything's going, just because the whole world's changing and noticing and trying to set a new standard. So,
Don?
Yeah, I mean, I think the same thing's happening in you know, for white people. Like, my parents' generation and the generation before that, mental illness was something to be ashamed of. You know, you're depressed. Why are you depressed? Get up. Go to work. Go, like, you know, for a walk or something. You got everything to live for, and you should be grateful and all that stuff. It's not as simple as that. It's complicated. And people have chemical imbalances and stuff like that. And so the younger people that are coming up now are more aware of all that stuff.
And that's
it's more accepting now.
That's scary now that you say that, because you have, like, conspiracy theorists that think that they have all types of crazy shit inside of them already. So when you tell them something like, hey, you know, you may have a chemical imbalance because of the way shit is, the way people are, like, mentally and shit, like, that may really stick with them. You won't go get checked out because of.
Well, I think a lot of people who are into conspiracy theories are very fearful people. They're very fearful. That is
some scary shit.
Needs to be addressed, too, itself. Like, I know people who are OCD, like, to be on, you wouldn't, like, washing their hands 8 times, 10 times in a row, who have told me they refuse to ever consider taking medicine. And I said, well, dude, you're smoking weed all day long to relax yourself. That's why not take a pill? Well, a pill is man-made. I'm like, all right, you're cutting yourself off from any possibility of living a better life, a happier life. You're spending 20 minutes washing your hands.
I mean,
you could be doing something that makes you happy.
Mm-hmm. Right? Like I smoke weed a lot, but I also take Adderall, and I also take stuff for my Lamictal, for my mood stabilizer and all of that shit. So smoking weed by itself, it's not. It'll put you to sleep. Okay, you won't get shit done at all. So like just.
Yeah.
I heard you say marijuana maintenance before. It's not good for your mentality. You won't think.
I mean, so, you know, it's got its place. Smoking weed, relaxing,
it does.
Everything, but it's not addressing the the bigger problem.
Yeah,
I take antidepressants too. I mean, you know, I have for 10, 15 years now, and I try to take them off them. It's not going to happen for me, at least not right now.
All the stuff I take is safe. And I surprised my psychiatrist because I wanted to come down on Adderall. So knowing that I got that shit under control too, is that good for my mental health? I don't know how we got right here, but yeah, that's good for my mental health too, knowing the fact that I can ease back with stuff like that.
Yeah, you're in control.
But yeah, it's only because you said smoking weed.
No, I didn't mean that or make that sound like a negative.
No. It's not. It is a negative when you just smoke weed.
Yeah, when you.
I'm saying that because, like,
right.
I am like a person that smokes a lot of fucking weed.
Yeah.
But.
And we love you.
I wouldn't want nobody to look. I wouldn't want nobody to look up to me like, yo, this nigga smokes weed, but it's like no, like I take other stuff too. So I'm here. Yeah, I'm high, right. But I'm here.
You're addressing your mental issues and then smoking weed recreationally.
Yep.
And listen, I come from a long line of alcoholics, all right? Here and across the pond in Ireland and Scotland. A lot of people use alcohol, and I'm sure many of my dead relatives did, to calm anxiety, right? To get like a little up feeling. When, ironically, it's a depressant.
Hell yeah.
So self-medicating through alcohol is a big thing.
Oh, no.
And I hear it. I'm in 12-step program. I hear it all the time at meetings.
I have to, like, in order to drink, I have to smoke weed. I have to smoke weed to drink.
Yeah.
Because I got fucked up the other day. And my brother-in-law, he's getting married. So I drink a lot, and I noticed then, like, I can't do that alone neither. If I was to drink alone, like just drink without smoking weed, it'd fuck me up mentally. So
you feel like shit the next day. Too.
Oh, yeah. Fuck yeah.
Oh, God. Horrible.
So, back to the topic of where we work, kind of. Do you think celebrities had an effect on the fact that we're looking at mental health so closely now?
I think them talking about it more, I think that definitely helps. When you have major faces addressing an issue as an issue,
mm-hmm.
when you have just more people who you look up to saying that something is valid, anyone who has actual mental health, and I have to say that because especially in the minority community, a lot of people use it as an excuse
to not
do anything, right? Like, and I don't mean that, like, oh, we don't have people who have issues. We have people who realize that to be clinically crazy can get you a lot of benefits that feel that those are our reparations in a sense, right? And I don't say this talking out my ass. I hear people literally say these things and talk about it and advise you to follow their moves, right, within our community. So when you have
reparations
for
slavery?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But as far as those with actual issues, because of the way that the majority of the community views mental health problems, right, you're told, oh, you just need, like, you need some water. Or you just need to relax, have a drink, have a smoke, whatever,
yeah.
right? You know, because we come from a community that has had to deal with so much hardship that to address the mental hardship, people are like, oh, you feeling sad? We all have a sad life. Like, you know, really, that's why we take it in jest, because our entire story on this side of the world is nothing but struggle. That for you to feel like you have a reason to be sad is like, no, boo-boo, you don't. But some people are depressed because of a chemical imbalance, because of whatever other reason. Some people really do suffer PTSD just from living in the hood, because you see death every day, that numbness or whatever. You know, especially if you're in Chicago, you know, they call it Chirac. You know what happened to people who actually went to Iraq and Afghanistan. So just like the reality of it is that when there are more people that are respected, acknowledging something as valid, there are so many more people who've been feeling a certain way that speak out. I mean, we see it. You know, it's not the same difference, but when more people are willing to open up about their sexuality and how many more people feel now that they can express themselves, you know, that's the same thing. When someone's able to start a trend, like be able to be the first person to say something, so many more cases. I mean, look at Tiger Woods and how many women said they slept with him. Look at Bill Cosby, the number of people who said he was throwing pills. It's just when the first voice gets out there, many more feel able to say their story. Yep. And that's just how it works.
To piggyback off something that you just said with the sadness, on my other show, I spoke about it. I'm tired of hearing people that saying, oh, my God, my so-and-so person died. I am so depressed. No, you're not, bitch. You're sad. I'm tired of them saying they're depressed, because then it takes away from the people that are really depressed.
Yeah, right.
You're not depressed. You're sad.
Right.
It's two different things. You know what I'm saying? Off balance. Uh-huh. A moment of in your life that is going on.
Yeah.
Two different things.
A lot of people love to over exaggerate their personal issues too. That's a valid statement. But I think that becomes a very iffy ground to then invalidate someone's feelings.
Right. Yep. Right. And that's where you can't.
Yeah.
Nowadays.
You gotta leave it up to a professional.
But in truth of fact is, you're yesterday, for the past years, you were happy, dory, nothing, and all of a sudden someone passed away, you're sad. Oh, I'm depressed.
That's someone unable to cope with death.
Yeah, it's just, that's what I'm saying. That's a sadness versus someone that has the mental imbalance. Like, because all my life, I thought I was just sad, you know, until I went to one person, and the psychiatrist says, you ever got diagnosed? And I was like, no, why? It's like, because you have all the traits of someone that has depression. And I'm like, why? She's like, because I can look at you. Your eyes always turning. You're sad. You know, your movement, your body. And when I took a test, I found out. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why I kept staying in my house. Yeah. This is the reason why I kept doing stunts and all these stuff, because I didn't want to think about it.
Right.
And nowadays, a lot of the celebrities who be like, oh, you know, help with depression. Sometimes I'll be like, yeah, you're just trying to say it because, you know, you're a celebrity using that stat as it. But the real ones that really have it haven't really spoke up. Look at Robert Williams. He didn't speak up until he died.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
There's a temptation to hide out when you're really depressed. You want to, because you don't want the rest of the world to see you like that.
It's a shameful thing. Right. It's the word itself. Like, this is the word saying the word depression itself, and admitting that you're fucking depressed, or even going to seek out help for depression.
Because a lot of the people that are sad, you tell them, have you ever sat down and then just started, like, crying or just felt like you didn't want to do nothing? Nah. So then you don't have depression.
And that's
where... You're sad.
That's where, like you said, that's where that fine line is. That's where you need a professional at.
Right.
Because you can't really say that. Oh, you're just sad. I mean, there's a difference, but they also, like, they run... It's anonymous.
Right, right.
So...
And also, like, you know, in this country, I feel like we're always told, like, from childhood to smile. Be happy.
Yeah, smile, happy.
What if I'm fucking not happy? What if I don't want to smile? Yeah. Recently, I posted a picture of myself on Instagram, and one of the people that commented said, it'd be better if you were smiling. And I want to say, fuck you.
Why do I got to smile?
Why do I have to smile? To please you?
To make them feel comfortable, I guess.
No, and they used to say that about me. They was like, they used to call me antisocial when I was younger.
Yeah, yeah.
You're always antisocial. You only hang out with those three or four guys because those three or four guys knew my emotions, like the up and down.
Right, they understood you.
You know what I'm saying? Versus I'm antisocial because I don't want to talk to you. First of all, I don't know you.
Right.
Second of all, I'm feeling that depression that I don't even want to be here. But I'm here because if I leave, I'll be, like, outcasted or something like that, you know?
I think the other thing is that culturally, right, when someone else is sad, I don't think a lot of us have an idea of how to help or assist, so it makes us feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Like, you ever had someone just cry in front of you and you're just like, what the fuck do I do?
Right.
Like, well, it's not like with a baby, you can just pick them up and cool them or feed them or something, so, like, I think that sense of making others uncomfortable became, like, you need to pretend like you're happy in our culture. And, I mean, you go back two or three generations, that was, like, the number one reason where, like, everybody's just like, you need a man, nope, don't do this, don't do that. Like,
not only that, oh, look, he's just looking for attention.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So
it's an act.
Yeah. It's all right. I don't feel good. just go get something to eat. You'll be all right. You know, shake it off.
Go
you know
get
what I'm
some pizza, bitch.
Yeah, you'll
like,
be good. Stop watching those sad movies. Like, I wasn't even watching nothing. Like, you know what I'm saying? But I guess back in those days, they didn't know, you know?
Well,
it was just...
You know, Calvin's right. I'm not Calvin. I'm sorry. If you don't know how to handle somebody's sickness, somebody's sadness,
you're not gonna.
It's gonna make you feel uncomfortable, and you don't want. You know, you're gonna just want it to go away, right? Mm-hmm. You're gonna just want it. You're tempted to say, "Be happy, smile."
And right now, I'm in a fucked up position right now because, like, for the last 6 months, I can't fulfill my wife's, like, my her mom not being here, so it's in a tough spot. Like,
you're trying to help, but you can't.
It's nothing I can do, right? I can't say, like, it's gonna be okay because it's not. So,
right,
that's why I said, like, with sadness,
but that
mom passed.
Yeah, but that part comes with the depression because a lot of the people that have depression always feel like they're the ones that's supposed to help the other ones because it helps them, and when you can't. It feels like you're more stuck. You know, like if my kid wants something and I can't really get it, my depression will hit even harder because I'm like, I'm
you
supposed
know
to. And that's where it comes from.
I think you may have finally helped me figure out what the fuck it is. That's why everybody's getting the shits from me. It's like, it's nothing I can do.
Dude, but your brain would not let you
acknowledge it's nothing I can do. So, like, everybody around me is getting, like, the big, unnecessary, like, the tone
attitude.
Of fuck you.
Yeah.
But I don't mean it. So I guess that's why everybody's calling me a dick.
Yeah, and it's just
that
because
and you're an asshole.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know.
Maybe what you could do is your wife...
I love through comedy.
Religious?
Huh?
She believe, oh, you could say, listen, honey, I'll pray for you.
Oh, we got the candles up and all that. It's the fact that...
We got the candles out. What is this? Man.
Well, she is Spanish, so she got the... She got the white candle in the front door,
the
big one, white one. Why's the white one for? That's for purity.
Yep.
Get me a yellow one. You know, they got color candles.
My mother-in-law, as soon as I walk in, that's what's right there. Like, yeah.
Yeah, that's so basically what they do.
It's like, I can't do nothing. Yeah, thank you. But now I know why everybody's getting a shitty tone from.
Yeah, it's
man. You care too much.
And it's,
you know what you just do? You just, if you have nothing to say, you just say, I feel your pain, I know.
I would not say I feel your pain because that's the first thing to set a motherfucker off.
Fuck, you know your mom and dad is there.
I'm sympathetic to you.
I've been through it.
I told her straight up. Like, I had to, like, straight up tell her.
I can imagine.
I know I can't.
Yeah, that's the one.
I can imagine.
what you're going through. Mm-mm. Meaning I just, that I didn't probably go through it, but I can probably picture it. But if you say, I know how you feel, yeah, if I know how you feel.
I told her straight to her face, baby, I don't know what to do. I just know that I can't
see,
replace.
But you're taking the knowledge, man, that's what's good.
To, that's the only thing I can do.
Yeah.
But I'm here.
Yeah, of course. That,
but I'm here for you.
Because there's certain things, like when my mom passed away, I was about 22 when I had to pull the plug. I'm the youngest boy. That affected me big time. I lost memory and all that. So when the people came and tell me, I understand what you... Did you ever unplug your mother? Did you ever figure it out? I was so, like, angry when people would ask and tell me these things. Yeah. So there are certain words you cannot say. Not even the prayer. Like, my aunt came, and she's religious. Oh, my God, I'll pray for you. Was you praying for her when she was in the hospital? I was, like, so, like, teed off.
You were mad at the world.
Because I was the one that had to do that decision when... I'm in college. My decision was to pass the next semester. You know what I'm saying? Not to come over here and find out this.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's some anger. You know how the stages of grief.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's certain things that you can't say, but as a person with depression, it's even worse. Yeah. Like, I didn't even know that I was even more aggressive than a normal person of grief.
Sure.
So it's hard. Like, what Calvin's going through is that part where you want to be the savior. But you can't, and now it's double time, you know?
And I hate the people I come across. I really do. I hate it for them, I mean.
Yeah.
They
They're going
to... I hate it because to me, I sound like I sound to y'all, but apparently that's not what's coming out.
Hmm. It's a tough situation, especially when you care as much as you do for, like, your spouse.
Yeah.
Then know that, you know, you're supposed to be their rock and you just can't do anything right now. That's a difficult spot to be in. And then even more so because you're a man, as much as, you know, our whole masculine culture is supposed to be like that provider, that savior, that hero, and you have nothing that you can do right now. Right. It's a hard place to be in. It really is.
But I did make a laugh. Like, I make a laugh again. So that is something.
That's because your ass is funny as fuck.
Yeah, thank God. Thank you, Trish.
Sometimes you have to figure out a way, like, to laugh. And I think that's why half of the greatest comedians had depression.
Yeah.
You know, the stunt, because I didn't even know Evel Knievel had depression. And this is the reason why he was doing all those stunts.
Yeah, that makes some damn sense. Let me just see if I can kill myself.
You know, because his brain wanted to leave that.
Having fun. Yeah,
leave that part away. Every time he felt something, he would go out and try something just for he won't.
If I blow up in the fucking air, so be it.
Yeah, you know?
At least I was having fun, so. And which leads me to the personal, the environmental issues on your mental health, like the effect.
What affects my mental health?
Yes.
Stupid people.
I was waiting on it.
Stupid ass answers. Don't ask me no stupid answers because it pisses me off even more.
So knowing that, like, does that fuck with you at all?
Well, it did. So I just learned how to be sarcastic and laugh about it so it won't trigger me. Because the thing is about depression, you have to find out what's your triggers. So as I learned what my triggers are, because I write it down. Every time I get depression, what was I doing? Or what did I eat? You know, and then I look back at it to see if it matches. So one of those were when people ask me those stupid questions, I started just making jokes or like, hey, I didn't know you were over here. Oh, were you looking? You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, like I'll be saying this. So they look at you like with that dog look.
Exactly.
Like, you know, like, so it helps me knock that down real quick.
Yeah.
I think for me, it's like, so like in this, in AA, you know, they teach you that your sobriety, your mental health, your peace of mind is as good as your connection with your higher power. Like, right. You know, your daily routine, praying, meditating, whatever it is, whoever you believe in, whatever. And for me, I know that I want to like kill people for the slightest thing they do when I'm not doing all those things. Right. When I'm not praying, meditating, reading good stuff, you know. Mm-hmm.
You got to like, know yourself to maintain control.
Yeah.
Getting annoyed by, you know, like, assholes on social media who are like
he's right here. Can't talk to him.
I knew
like
he was
that.
Gonna say it.
He's so right here.
I'm trying to get rid of the fucking stigma of being a goddamn asshole. I swear,
it's literally your social media name. Like, you are doing a terrible job at getting rid of the stigma.
So, even if I got rid of my fucking name, I don't think that'll help.
No, but it's asshole anonymous, which means
I'm not supposed to know you're an asshole.
Yeah. No, but to piggyback off what you say, sometimes when someone says something like triggers me or either anger trigger or depression trigger, I stay silent. And then I just look at them. And they think that I'm thinking of something. No, I'm meditating, because if I don't.
If I open my mouth, I'm either going to say some fucked up shit.
Or not.
Look over there.
No, that's what I was going to say. Look, sometimes when I really, really know that I'm going to say something to attack, I even look at my wife, or if I'm around Will, I look at him. You know, he probably doesn't know it, but I'll look at him.
Oh, I know it. I know why he's looking at me.
Woo! Meditate.
Look over there.
Take the breath, and then I'm cool. You know, yeah. I'm like, take the breath, and then I just think of something else.
That's great, man.
That's
what I said. Find your trigger and find the thing that will help you stop it.
Yeah.
And it works. It's been working for me. You know, sometimes I'll slip, but you know, it's a process. You know,
I think the shortcut that I take is sort of kind of like that, let go and let God. So like, why am I going to be any happier if I control something? No, I'm just gonna. I gotta let it go.
Yeah.
Like, I don't need to control this.
I can do something better.
I can do something more constructive.
Right. I think, is that a depression? Because half of the people I speak to that have depression, they have that problem of letting the control go.
No, those are just people who are type A's.
Yeah, A's.
They're just dominant personalities. Yeah. You know, like it's so hard to let go of control if you're someone who's used to dominating something.
Something.
You know, like if you're the one that who's often have had to be responsible for, you know, let's say your siblings or this or whatever, taking care of yourself, you're so not used to giving away control because you've always had to be the one in control for anything to function.
Yeah.
Eric told me, and see, this is what's fucked up, but Eric said, the fact that I give somebody that makes me more of an asshole. Fact that I'm like, yo, you're the dominant one, bye-bye, right? Because of me doing that, I'm more of an asshole for it.
Isn't that more so just how you say it?
Huh?
Isn't that more so in how you say it? Like, oh, you're the boss. You got it.
It's just me in general.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, that's why I'm like, oh, everybody's telling me all types of different shit. He's like, just the fact that you're like,
You're good.
Yeah,
bye-bye. Stay the way you are.
Yeah, I think the difference becomes if you're someone who shrugs off the responsibility because you don't want to have to deal with it, then you're an asshole. If you're someone who's willing to, you know, just kind of give them that control, either A, because you know the other person can't cope without it,
right,
or because you know this is something that you're not particularly skilled in or whatever. Like, if it isn't just because you're shrugging off responsibility, perhaps you think the person has a better idea, what the case may be, you're not an asshole for giving that up. Is that if you're not able to stand up for yourself or do what you should be able to do, then you're kind of an asshole because you're just like, I don't want to have to deal with stress, with work, with whatever. Like, responsibility can be yours because I don't need this shit.
Yeah.
Then you're an asshole.
Well, if somebody comes at you, let's say my worst case scenario, I meet somebody at a party who thinks Donald Trump was the greatest president America ever had.
Oh, you hate that
motherfucker. Oh, man, of course he was.
You see his face? I wish the viewers, he was about to jump over the table.
So, like, I might,
hola, presidente.
Hey, no.
I might engage and argue with them for, like, a few minutes, but then there's no way I'm going to change his fucked up mind.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's
that
no
point.
Way. So then I just got to say to myself, whatever.
I think the greatest response when someone says it is like, how? You hit them with the, ¿cómo?
Yeah.
But you know, a lot of times that people do call you asshole or you're a jerk or something like that is when you tell them the truth.
Yep.
If they be like, yo, can you do this? Nah, I can't do that because I got, oh, he's an asshole.
Hit him
well, how
him?
You going to call me an asshole for asking my favor and I can't do it? So you're the asshole. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, I've always done that, though. No.
Yeah. Don't let the word get to you. Like,
can
if
you
they
do
bother
it?
You,
no.
Oh,
no.
I can't do it.
No.
Do you want to? No.
I don't see the point.
Even if you don't want to, like, yay, I would love to do it. Like, you know, I can be like, oh, man, I want to go skydiving. And then this guy says, hey, you want to go skydiving? I'd be like, nah, I don't want to. You know what I'm saying? It's
not
my opinion. I want to do it, but not
you
with
suck
you.
Suck as a person. I'm good.
Yeah. I just don't want to hang with you. That's it. So,
more about you guys.
I've definitely been the person to, like, someone asked me, oh, you want whatever? Nah. And then I end up at a bar, and then they show up there. Oh, I thought you said you were going somewhere else.
Changed
yeah,
my mind.
Yeah, I was. And then I was just like, no, I was just thinking that because you wanted to hang with me. And they're just looking at you. I'm like, I don't care about you.
Yeah,
no,
like, yeah.
Yep, and they're like, oh, you're so funny.
No, like, oh, you're fucking serious.
I know, right? You ever did that? Like, you tell somebody the truth, and they be like, yes. This guy's hilarious. I'm like, about no. What? I'm just telling you the truth. I don't want to hang with you.
No, me gusta.
Yeah, you don't get to get no smile or none of that shit, no.
No, not a wink, nothing.
So,
No,
so back to you guys, yourselves again. What does the media have on your mental health? Does it have an effect on it?
Hell no.
I think I answered that already.
Right? Stupid questions.
See, no, let me explain this to you. The media has no effect on my mental health for two reasons. One, I do my own research.
Yeah.
Right? So when I hear something on TV and they want to scare you into whatever, I have to first be like, you know what? Okay, that's interesting. Let me look that up. Let me, you know, and you look at various resources, whatever. And then you're like, okay, well, what they're saying makes sense. What they're saying is true. Even sometimes if you're watching something on, let's say, Channel 4, I want to see if Channel 2 is saying the same thing. I want to see if Channel 7 is saying the same thing. Channel 11. Because if there's usually a lack of consistency on things that are still under debate.
Yeah.
But they're going to spin the story that sounds the best, right? If I hear something online and I just, you know, if I don't agree with the person or whatever, I don't usually comment. I'm just normally like, let me just remove any notifications of this post. Or if someone says some real, like, offensive shit, I just hit the block button. I don't know if it's because I'm an Aquarius, because they say that we do this too easily, but, like, to cut people off, it's like, oh, bye.
Bye. I got people anyway.
Yep. Yeah, that, you know
I
what
got
I'm saying?
People.
So I don't let stuff affect me. If I think in any way, shape, or form something is going to be negatively affecting me where I feel like I'm going to be overstressed for no reason. Because there's a good kind of stress, right? There's like when you're trying to accomplish something and it's hard, but the reward's going to be worth it. Or,
yes.
You know,
that's
a good kind of stress because you're like, you know, you're trying to get it done, but there's a time crunch or it's a hard thing. Mm-hmm. But to something that's going to end up with no real value, to someone who's going to end up with no real value, deuces, real quick. So if I don't like a TV network, I don't watch it. If I don't support what they're going, I don't watch it anymore.
It's all about
like,
making good choices, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't think
there's 1,000 channels, there's a million movies, a billion, 7 billion people. If I choose not to fuck with one thing, there's another option. You know what I'm saying? That's how I get through it. Yeah, I just switch it.
I don't think the media is what stressed me. It's the people that believe the media or what they see
Definitely.
On the posts. Oh, yes. Those are the people that stress me. Like, did you do your research first? Oh, no, they said that. Of course they said it.
Yep.
Like, here you go.
Why are they valid? Why do you think that you're not?
Did you understand who's this, when they did this, who came out? And No.
Oh,
they only go with what
YouTube.
That's the people that.
Bro, but YouTube is life.
And some media is more guilty of that than others. But
oh, yeah, there's some media that, oh, we did our research. Now, back in the days, remember when they used to have the reporters that used to go and it would take them months to do a story. And come back out? No, they want to grab the story real quick without even knowing.
Well,
and then try to change their theory next week.
Well, the other thing is that people get their news from these analysis shows.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's not where you're supposed to get your news from, because they're talking about the news the way they see the news.
Yes, yeah, opinions.
Right? And it's a gamble.
They're opinion shows. Don't get your news from the Five. Channel
some of them
Fox.
Say the fucking the name opinion
well,
in the show.
Fox. So anyone who uses Fox News as a credible source. Now, don't get me wrong. Sometimes they actually do drop news, and I normally fact check that with several other sources when that happens. But like, they've literally admitted to coming up with farce stories to promote their political goals.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I think Fox is the only one that did it.
Like, they had to apologize to the voting machine company.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
My whole thing is this. If these guys, I'm not saying they've been caught. That's one thing, you know, you catch people doing whatever. If they've come out of their own ass to tell you we're making fake stories, right? Like, it's like the Inquirer or whatever
National
it is.
Inquirer.
Right? And they're like, we come up with fun stories just to entertain you, right? Or like The Onion was supposed to be a gag newspaper. If you're taking your research or your information, your facts from places where they're like, we fudge stuff intentionally, that's on you for remaining stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's not like you can say, oh, I believe these guys, whatever, and then you find out after the fact they've been lying to you. you know, I mean, granted, some of the stuff sounded off in the first place, but like I said, occasionally there's a real news story on Fox News, so you believed it.
Right.
But you as a person have to hold responsibility for when you for the words that come out your mouth. So if you're taking your information from false places, you're the asshole.
Can you call up Trump and tell him that?
Oh no, I enjoy
that
him.
Last thing.
I enjoy him.
You as a person have responsibility for the words that come out of your mouth.
Please, see, I can say that, but it'd be followed by and thank you for being the asshole that you are.
Yeah.
Because all right, lo and behold, how many people are really talking about anything Biden and Harris are doing in office on the daily, the same way that they were about Trump every day? The news is boring now. If you really want some entertaining news, you have to start watching shit from Africa. You got to start going on looking at what Putin's doing in Russia. You know what I'm saying? Like, I will always love a bad president for the wrong reasons. And it's mostly because I love how much everyone gets pissed off at them.
Oh, okay.
Right? Their entertainment value holds worth the bullshit.
It's all types of entertainment value.
Because the be-all end-all is, even with the Republican Congress, they didn't pass more than half of his agenda because of how ridiculous it was. So there is a form of government to keep you in check, not to mention when you get to the judicial. So you can be as shitty of a president as you want because, in all honesty, in this country, the president is really more of a place figure than an actual sense of authority.
Now we know who the fuck the day is.
They?
We know who the fuck the day is. The day that keeps shit in control. You just said
it's
it.
The media.
The Illuminati.
That's who the fucking day is right there.
Who? The media?
They.
The Illuminati.
They.
The Illuminati.
He was just talking about the people in between Congress that keep shit running. That's who the fuck they is.
Oh. Okay.
The people that I said the Illuminati. The president and everybody else.
I mean, I don't think they call it. That's too fucking obvious. It's like, if that was.
The best lie is the truth.
Yeah, absolutely fucking correct. Before I was about to say no, but yeah, you're right.
If I tell you the sky is green and you're gonna look at me like, oh no, you're stupid. And yet, if we really do the scientific research, it's actually green. It's because you're like, but why does it look blue? You don't need to know that. It just is.
Is it really green?
No, it's not. But you see how you question it? That's my whole point. So if I told you that there's a secret organization of people who run everything in the goddamn world, you're gonna be like, nah, that shit's crazy. And then there actually is. So, like, you
no,
that the best lie is the truth.
It looks blue because it's reflecting off of the water. Right? You know? Is that the wrong answer?
No,
yes. That's the general joke answer that, like, you tell kids. It has to deal with something with, like, the molecules and refraction of stuff in the air. Yeah. Exactly. It's all scientific and shit.
You see how fast you just had them go, wait, what is it? Right? My dad did that to my cousin and had him believe that the earth was flat. He said, my dad. My dad,
all you have to do is say, yo, you didn't hear it in the media?
A lot of fucking
he looked
real,
down.
Though.
That's all you got to
no,
do.
No, he physically, my dad like stood up on top of the steps and did this right here. He was like, look, he's like, you see how it goes flat over the horizon like that? He was like, shit, yeah. And my dad was like, you can see the fucking birds chirping around this nigga's head. he was really sitting there like, shit. He had him sitting there like that fucking fast. Thinking they got their
but you see,
flat.
With so much followers nowadays, you basically can say anything. You know, turtles are flying lately. They're hitting too much of the trees, so they have to, you know, kill the turtles.
It's not just the
they were like,
thing.
What? Yeah, you didn't hear it in the media? Oh, yeah, then it must be true.
No, but.
You know what I'm saying?
The thing is, it's not just today. Throughout history,
you're right.
Anyone who speaks with enough confidence, right? It may, because you know how I can talk very like monotone, right?
Right.
And I'll lie dead to your faith in a monotone just to be an asshole,
and
people will believe
right.
it as fact because I you know,
you
look
just did it to me
exactly. But that's the whole thing. If you say stuff with enough conviction, because there's so many people who want to be moved, right? It's the same way that cults work. It's the same way that, you know, Hitler was able to take over a whole country and almost the whole world. You have to an authoritative voice. And mindset is enough to move the masses.
And if you keep repeating the lies.
Over and over.
Yeah,
exactly.
Over and over.
Consistency above all else. That's how you get away with murder. So tell your story. Stick to it. No variations. They don't have enough evidence 90% of the time. I'm just telling you that's your
look at the youngest con artist. He was a doctor. He was FBI. He was a businessman.
What? The FBI wasn't around when Christopher Columbus came through.
Yeah, that's true.
Wait, who was that? Was that that? They made a movie out of it?
Yeah, they made a movie out of it. Can You See Me?
Did he really fly
Catch
the plane?
Me If You Can.
Yep.
Yeah.
He really? No, but he didn't fly the plane. That was the myth. And he told the story. He went there and he was so confident that he made the co-pilot fly the plane.
Right. He was like, oh, you know what?
He would say, let's see what you know. You know, what? Then he said he lied about a couple of stuff to see what the co-pilot says. And he says, I think you know what you're doing. Let me see if you can fly the plane. But he did it with so confidence that the guy flew the plane.
My grandmother told me a story once in the depth of the Depression. She was like in her 20s or whatever. Mm-hmm. She got an interview as a telephone operator. And that was back in the day where you plugged wires and stuff.
Right, the old school one.
So they asked her on the interview, do you know the XX system, the latest Bell telephone, whatever system, exchange system? And she says, oh, yeah, I know that one. Yeah, I have a lot of experience on that. So they brought her to the thing, and the guy says, okay, transfer this call to blah, 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 blah. She goes, you know what? This one is a little different from the one that I used. He sat down with her and showed her half an hour how to work this thing.
Oh, my God. It was a confidence.
This is the height of the Depression. There are a million looking for that same job.
But that's what it is. I mean, how many people are told, you know, you have to embellish on your resume, right?
Oh, yeah.
And don't think that they don't check you at the interview, but if you know your resume, like, you know, where you lied on, you'll have the story ready to back up any inconsistencies they may think exist. It's so easy to get a job as long as you have this certain personality. And you may be a completely different worker when you get there, right? They don't know that. You got to play the part.
Yeah, after that, you change your mind. You don't want to work overtime. Right. You don't want to do the job.
That's pretty much they got 90 days to see the interview you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. After the 91 day, that's a different person.
You said I passed probation yesterday? You about to find out how much time I got.
The 91 day, I'm more late. They talking about you never late. Nigga, I'm already past my parole. Right. I'm done.
Get past that.
Like in my resume, I was a duplication engineer for 2 years.
What's that?
A copy boy.
Oh my God.
You see?
But they was like, wow, that was cool. A duplication engineer. What you were doing? Oh, I was making copies.
I was duplicating.
Fuck around.
That's what I mean. And either if you're a duplication engineer, you're either a copy boy,
you know,
or a Catholic father.
Yeah. There you go.
My dad, like my dad.
Yeah. You're from the duplication. From the duplication.
I have like 13 kids.
He had 8. 10, I think, with 2 miscarriages.
There you go.
Yeah. You're one of those Spanish priests.
What's your last question?
Yo, what the fuck, dude? Like,
you're a Pentecostal duplication engineer.
Now, your family. What does your family effect have? Blah, blah, blah. Your family, what is does it play any part?
Nothing, because I don't really care for them. What does your family play in
your mental health? Shit, I can't even get the fucking word out.
Oh.
Nothing, because your real family is mostly your friends and the people you meet. Because your real
what
family,
what effect does your family have on your mental health?
It sounds like in Charles' case, it's more so that he removes the headaches.
Yep.
It's not even worth it, if any.
No, but I'm saying, like, remember I told you about, like, stupid people.
Yeah.
If you're my family, blood, and you ask me a stupid question, you cut. Because you're supposed to know better. You know what I'm saying? Stuff like that. Like, if you do something to irritate me, and you're supposed to know better, then I'm going to eliminate that because you're not going to stress my life.
And I don't saw that.
You know what I'm saying?
Fucking cousins in the fucking first
place. You're not going to stress my life out. Because, you know, as you get older, you have your own set of life. Like, you have your own wife, your husband, blah, blah, blah. They have their own wives, husband, whatever. But they want to put themselves in your life and screw your life up, and then they go home happy? No, that's not going to happen this way. You know what I'm saying? So you cut them.
Well,
the family should know better.
You're making choices.
Yeah. You know you can forgive a friend faster than you will forgive a family, and that's one of the reasons. Because your family member's supposed to know better.
That's so true.
You know,
you can prick your finger, but you can't finger your prick.
I beg to differ.
I was waiting. I was like, what? So that prick, I didn't finger her that good?
Give me a pool stick.
Right?
Hey.
No, but that's understandable.
Too thick.
Talk.
It depends on what end of the pool cube you're using.
Mm-hmm. I think Calvin's whole world just got spun for a second.
Splattered, nigga.
You don't see the birds? You don't see the birds?
Like, we just splattered all over the fucking place.
Want to ask me that question?
Go, absolutely.
All right. So I have family members that are very supportive. We're very supportive of each other because we've each gone through our own mental health issues.
Right.
I'm not naming names. but you know who you are.
Motherfuckers.
And, you know, those are my good friends in my family because I feel like I can go to them with anything.
Mm-hmm. Well, I got some family members I fuck with.
That you're going to go visit
but
soon.
You notice some of them that you can mess with, like they're there for you, but as soon as you mention, like, depression or something, they don't. They pull away because they don't really know how to.
Hey, so that cookout's in June, R.I.P.
Yeah. you start like, yo, man, I'm falling into depression. Yeah, oh, damn. What time were we supposed to be? Like, you know what I'm saying? They'll try to change the subject. Right.
I'm the guy. I'm the guy.
I'll be back later.
Yeah.
I'm that dude that's like, yo, uh-huh, yep.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So they hit you with that. I think that's my phone.
Right. And then your phone actually rings.
But like, the thing about it was, another thing that brought this up was, the fact that I caught myself the other day telling somebody, like, yo, take care of your fucking mental health, because they're dealing with something. I'm like, did I just say that shit?
Because you recognize it.
I'm like, why did I say
that? Maybe you could put it another way. Maybe you could say, I hope you're doing all right. Feel better.
In that situation in particular, it's very, very, very fucking difficult. Yeah. The only thing I could say was, like, to be broad with it and just say, hey, man, do what's best for your mental health.
Good. All right.
Well, it came out of your mouth. You know what I do? A lot of times, let's cut you off, but when I see someone that's like the same, like I see myself in that person, I walk by and be like, hey, good morning. How you doing today? You doing good? All right. And I just keep on going. They be looking at me like, hey, and with that smile. And I'm like, okay, I can put a smile on that person's face. First of all, I do it for two reasons. One, because I can feel them. Two, I don't need another crazy person in the street about to kill somebody. You know what I'm saying?
That's true.
Let me get this guy in a good mood. So he could get the next person in a good mood and he could keep on tringling around.
Pay it forward, baby.
That's
how it works.
That's the kind of thing that changes someone's day. Like,
just the hello.
I can tell you straight up, I'm the type of person to more so be like, if I see a beautiful person and just be like, yo, I think you're beautiful, and keep it pushing. And it just changes the, like, oh, okay, he wasn't even trying to hit on me. Like, nah, just.
I do that to guys all the time at the gym, and then somehow I always get beat up.
Fuck you say, nigga?
Dude.
What?
Dude.
Okay, do you go and say you're a beautiful person, or do you go, damn, I want to lick you up and down?
No, you know what it is? There's a whole technique.
Motherfucker be like this, like.
No, there's a whole technique at the gym. You go, dude, what do you do for those arms? Those arms are, like, immense. Those are massive arms. They light up. They say, oh, thanks so much. Yeah, this is what I do, blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, I'm thinking,
can you wrap
them up? Yeah. Keep on talking to me, bro. I got you.
They tell you, just like, look you down your eye.
Yeah, I'm getting there.
Look you down your eye.
At the end of it, you go, so can I get a
hug? Listen, how about we...
Can I have a hug? Let's go to the locker room.
No, and then they poke up a little more. They be like putting their chest out more.
Let's go, my nigga.
So how about we go out to my car and talk about those shoulders?
Yeah.
Tell me what's going on with them. No, I don't.
Be like, let me write this down. Come to me in my car. I got a pen in my car.
Gonna write my number on your cup there.
Wait, don't you have your phone in your hand? No, but in my car it's better.
Yeah, much better.
I got candy.
Got some candy for you.
That won't work at the gym.
Right? I don't know.
Sugar? What's this thing called sugar?
It's gluten free, sugar free.
No, you gotta say. You gotta say I got a protein shake.
Got a protein shake, right?
There we go.
I gotta be taking all kipes away. Kipes.
No, you're taking it the right.
You heard kipes? I said kipes. All kipes away.
Uh-huh. I got some protein in the
car. I don't know what the fuck he was talking about.
Chicken cutlets. That's what he's talking about.
Chicken cutlets.
Titties.
Titties and chicken cutlets. Some mayonnaise and tartar sauce.
What? How dare you disrespect the chicken cutlet with some mayonnaise and tartar sauce?
Oh, let me tell you some funny shit real quick. So I went to Popeyes to get the little thing for my daughter, the little chicken tenders, and in there they put tartar sauce.
What kind of fool?
And my daughter was like,
oh, you mean in the packet of it?
Yeah, like they put that in there, like the packet of fucking tartar sauce. So my daughter looked at me like,
what is this?
Trying to be funny, nigga? Like, are you fucking
serious? She thought it was you?
Huh? No, like she just looked at me like,
These fools crazy.
And then she finally like, yo, like they actually put tartar sauce in the fucking Popeyes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wait, that's for fish, though, isn't it?
Exactly.
That's what, is it the fact that I
tartar
said...
Tartar sauce is normally just for fish, but
I said chicken cutlets and tartar sauce is not. I just thought that dawned on me that actually happened.
Maybe they used fish bread or something. I don't know.
No.
They thought it was
I don't think that's fish.
Maybe they just fucked up on the order. They put
They totally just grabbed, like, where are the condiments at?
No, or maybe no, they recognize you from another episode on XY101.
The bitch up there, that Popeyes, they got mad at her because she, like, literally took the fucking fries and measured the fries out in her hand and put them in the box.
Oh.
So,
wait, did she have a glove on?
Yeah, yeah. Like, she measured, like
even
to get,
the, glove, I don't
to get the exact amount. I guess there's, like, some fucking standard amount back there that you're supposed to get.
Okay.
Yeah, you always get hooked up with fries that fucking piss at Popeyes, right? This bitch was, like, measuring out her hand, and she had an attitude about it. Yo, they was about to kill that bitch. She got fired, I guess. I haven't seen it then in a long
like
time.
Like a little shovel they're supposed to use.
Exactly.
Like McDonald's uses.
Yeah, a little shovel.
I guess it's, like, this much they're supposed to be able to.
Oh, okay.
And they grabbed it and put it in there, like, for whatever reason, like, two customers in particular were, like back to back. Like, yo, what the fuck? Right? And it turns out it was, the bitch was actually, like, measuring
I don't care if you got two gloves on. You've been touching any other stuff with that glove.
You know what? I didn't think about that shit neither.
But if I see you put a new glove on and touch my fries, then something's different. But you just came on backstage.
All of those fries, just like that.
That don't work for
me. I already asked family effects, so like,
it's a your family peer. Affair.
Your peers.
I'm glad you sang that song.
It's a family affair. You like that song?
Yeah.
I love that.
I was just thinking it, though, when he said it.
Do your peers have any...
one child.
I mean, I pretty much said it before, right?
That's what I'm saying.
Once you get on my nerves, I cut you out my circle. That's about it. That's what happened to Walpy.
Okay, I got to ask.
Wait, could I just go back for one second?
What? May I? May I pry? What did happen there?
He got on my nerves, so I cut him.
Who cut died? Him? Cut him? Literally?
Who died?
Oh, no. He ain't dead.
Oh.
Did you meet Wolpe?
It's very, very loud. Guy used to be here.
Dominican dude with the curly hair. Yeah.
Yeah, the loud kid that always want that center of attention thing.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So that was, I hate to trash
it. I put two and two together. You know? And if I would have bet my wife, I would have lost. Because I gave Will about 2-3 months before he would kick his ass to the curb. He took longer. My wife was like, how did you figure it? I was like, I know Will, and I see what he's doing. He's gonna do something stupid.
Yeah, that's what it was. He just said
stupid.
Because already he was getting on my nerves, and I only see him once a month.
You motherfucker.
I don't know if you ever noticed the difference.
No.
As soon as he came in, I just hear.
I go back and listen to everything. I'm like, okay, here's the tension right here.
You can hear. Listen to other episodes. You can hear the difference.
Hear like with anybody, even the interactions between everybody in this room. You could be like, all right, so there's tension. Well, there's never really tension here.
There really isn't.
So, but like if someone's here, you can tell the tension. Even... Since that person's since he's not here, it's calmed a lot. Like conversations flow a lot. There's not like a lot of in the middle.
Well, you can. There's times you can do that, but there were certain times like we had special guests or people that came in. They probably didn't want to come back because they was like, "Ooh, man, this is how."
So I mean, even to move away from that, it's people that I've had that's like, "Yo, you're weird, dude."
But
so
see, people like that do affect the emotion.
Yeah, it fuck with you. Especially,
yeah.
Well, I don't know how long you were around that person. Like, some people, I can't say I actually ever felt fucked up.
He had his good time.
There are certain people and certain that are different, right? Like a Walpy.
Yeah.
When you have someone like that with good intentions, like it's just that they're just an oddball, it doesn't bother me.
Mm-hmm.
When you have someone who's like that that just does something that's fucked up, now I just have my reason to get rid of you. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, it's not that certain people are annoying types. I mean, like, if you're an annoying type of good person, that's probably 90% of geeks.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, I'm used to that. That's not the issue. It's when you do something that's just blatantly disrespectful, that's when you get off my list.
Mm.
Plus, he's Dominican. A lot of Latin people that were brought up with their old Latin family from the islands, they take a little, sometimes a little too far.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So I already seen him going and go a little too far.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because some of the stuff that he be saying or some the way he be acting, I be looking at him, watching him, and I'm like.
And it's not like, once again, because I'm a nice guy. And so
it's just
one time that he went too far with me and I was able to keep my composure. But that little shit when he got like right here, it's like, yo.
Yeah.
Bubble.
Yeah, like, dude, you know what the fuck I do to you, but that's a whole nother issue that's not even worth mentioning.
Can I just get back for a second?
Yeah.
Remember when we were talking about the chick in the Popeyes with the fries?
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
You know what I think of when I see those people working in there?
What?
I mean, great people doing the hard work. Those are important jobs. When they go home, and they want to have sex with their partner. What does that shit smell like?
It smells like it smells like the restaurant.
No. I am with that shit.
Wait.
Bitch, I will eat you.
Exactly.
Hold on.
Put a little grease right here.
Hold on. For one minute.
I swear to God, I didn't think of that.
I don't even know goddamn myself.
Carl Quest. Did he just ask one of Carl's questions out of the blue?
Who's Carl?
My
Calvin. Creepy Uncle Calvin. So for him, I'm Carl.
That's Carl.
From him, hey, you get that privilege. He can call me Carl. Yeah, I call him Carl. Include you niggas.
That's my nickname for him.
I swear to God, I think of that every time I pull up.
Because that's one of his questions. He would just come out of the blue when we talk about a different conversation.
Because,
and then we're like, what?
Yeah, where that came from? Somebody who makes fries.
Because I used to work.
I love potato.
Yo, if it smells like that, I'm pulling out some shades.
See, this is what I like to tell people. I had to cuss out my friend the other day because she was just like, I don't really like french fries. I'm like, what?
What?
And they were like, what? What's the big deal? I'm like, look, my island is an Irish island, right? I grew up with a bunch of Russians. It's sacrilegious not to love potato.
Mashed potato, everything.
If it's potato, down to vodka. We love fucking potatoes.
Like who? There's people that go into the store and they'll be like, "Just give me large fries." And just a large fries.
Large fries, my nigga. My wife just the other day.
Just the large fries. That's
give me some fries.
Exactly.
So if it's coming home and smelling like that, I'm making some shakes. You be like, you smell like a number two.
That's the stuff.
Dude, that's what I was going to tell you. I used to work at a place called Captain Tom's. And one time I had a little situation that had to be attended to. And the bitch told me I smell like shrimp.
Shrimp?
Really?
I can smell the fried shrimp in your clothes.
Oh, my God.
Really?
Yes. On the person?
So then you had to show that you were black and not a shrimp, right?
Absolutely.
Now this is when you pull out the tartar sauce. Like
he shot it out.
You know what, bitch?
That's when you pull out the tartar sauce right there.
I got a little dip cups. Yo.
And I will allow you to double dip.
got a little dip cups. I'm putting the tip of my dick in. We can go ahead and get it popping, bitch.
Speaking of, all right, as long as you guys brought it up about, you know, the black.
It's allowed. Come on.
Yeah, it's allowed. You're one of us. Yeah, okay, okay.
You know what they say about Dominican guys?
Uh-oh.
What they say?
Dominican guys are huge.
They do? I never heard that.
The Dominican guys. They're very huge.
Well, they're very African, whether or not they like to believe
it. They like to believe it or not. You know? That's why it came from.
They were the African snitches. They swam, got away, and told everybody.
Why do you say that past tense?
No, they brought them there. Anyway, I always have to bring the conversation down.
You know I'm letting that shit. I'm not even going
to
say anything
else. No, but you know what's so funny? I used to hear a lot from blacks and Latin people. The girls used to be like, is he porno star thick or just regular? Like, what? Like, is he porno or regular? And I never thought of that until... like years ago when I was like, oh, okay, I understand what they're trying to say.
I've had conversations with straight women, and they would prefer...
when they would ask that?
Girth over length.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, girth over length.
You hit all the walls. So with that being said, on that note, this has been another episode of XY 101. We are out this bitch.
Oh, man. Oh, my God.